street notes that benefits letting people into the museum and trying to argue the case of why you should let students in and how it benefits you and the students. So in-person access is really about letting people into the collection, so getting the ability to handle objects and really just carry out any analysis. It's not really enough to just let students into your actual museum. They really do need to be able to actually interact with your collection. So often when students email museums, you might get a response saying, do you need to come in person? Or can we just send you a photo? Would that be good enough? And that kind of leads into, what about online access? So online access is a good first step into making your collections accessible to the public. It allows students and researchers a way to get an idea of what your collection has to offer. And it also is accessible worldwide, so you could have students in other countries look at your collection and use it for their work. But it does not replace in-person data collection. So it can't really help those who are wishing to do an anatomical analysis. And probably the more important part is the entire collection even online? So often when museums do have online collections, sometimes you might have just what's in the gallery. And it's often very rare that a student actually wants to look at something that's currently on display. Usually you'll get a blanket email saying, do you have anything that fits X, Y, or Z? And if you don't, you say no. And if you do, you do a collection search and then say, yes, we have 53 of these objects, we have no photos. And at that point, it might be easier to ask the student, can you come in person and just look at them because we don't have information. So there are cases where in-person access is needed, but it hasn't always been able to happen. So some of the things that have prevented it, this is not in order, it's just a bit of a mess. So one of the biggest things would be time constraints. So having people come in means you do need to have somebody supervise. So that takes time out of somebody's day, and it's a bit of a challenge if you only are in part-time. There's always, again, a risk of fear of damaged objects. Some museums might be a bit hesitant to let people in, especially if they've never handled museum objects before, and they're unable to offer full supervision. There's also communication failures. So emails get buried really easily, and sometimes you're in the middle of an email conversation with the curator, and then the student hears nothing for a month, and then another month, and it's because the email has just gotten buried. Other emails and it's got missed, and then once that communication breaks down, it's gone. Again, complications due to the pandemic. I know from my own work, I was planning on going to Lincoln to look at their coins, and they had collection management change over pandemic, and that just never happened. And you also have bureaucracy. So a lot of times there's a lot of paperwork that needs to be filled out, and some of that kind of prevents students getting access either. Signatures aren't able to get in time, or somebody up higher up in the food chain just says no. So, trying to make a case for in-person work. You can't always get a good sense of an object from a photo, so often really the only way to really understand the object is to see it in person. And that way you can get a better idea of construction, how it's made, what the material is, and any details that you won't see otherwise in photo, because again, the photo is a two-dimensional thing, and objects usually are not. Being in person also gives you the ability to do any chemical analysis or sampling, and because you're in person, you can actually ask real-time questions to the curators, which can be a lot more convenient than just trying to go back and forth by email, which may end up taking more time than just having some like, 5 minute conversation. As we learned from yesterday with going through older museum records, they can be wrong. And there's just not enough time or resources for the museum to really investigate every object they have in their collection. So having students who are interested in very obscure objects is actually a good benefit for you, because it means the work is going to get done. So, these are some of the expected benefits that museums often could think they would get when you have students in. So you could expect a copy of any data produced and piece work. You could use it as a showcase engagement a student might be able to write a blog post for your website, or they might be able to completely share the work they've done. You can also use this for public outreach. A museum will get credit for the objects, of course, and it's free publicity and free research. So, what about the student expectations? So I think one of the most important things that students get out of this is networking. Because students are still very early in their careers, they're still trained to become early career researchers, it's really important that they start building up networks now, so building connections, so when they do finally graduate, they will have that network there, so they can have contacts and be able to actually do things and meet people. You also have the ability of first-gen data collection, so students can be happy with whatever work they're producing. And it's also experience. Many students may not have previous experience working in a museum, and by allowing them into the collection, you're giving them that first step, getting that kind of experience. Again, it expands and tests their own knowledge, their understanding what they might expect to find versus what they actually find. And students often can expect new discoveries. Because most objects have not been analyzed in the past, any new information is going to be a new discovery. And this often leads to the unexpected. So having students come in to exchange of knowledge, both for the museum and for the student, students are training to become experts in their field, and they're able to share their expertise with the museum when they come in, and the museum can share their expertise with the student. It also allows museums access to new technologies, like we saw earlier, the XRF. And having people in and talking to people allows for new conversations that happen and spontaneous and unplanned work.
And we're going to go through some examples of that.
So recently I was in Bristol Museum, my own work, looking at Roman coins, and I was doing chemical analysis. And because I had a PXRF with me, I was able to actually look at the coins and actually see things in person. But the more exciting things actually happened that were not related to my thesis. So because I was in person, I was able to actually have conversations and talk to the curators. And I was able to talk to the ceramics curator. And she was telling me that she was sending things off for chemical analysis, taking an isotope analysis to ceramics, trying to see if she can get an idea of where the clays are coming from. And I offered, well, we have the XRF here, we may as well look at yourself in the XRF. We were mainly trying to look at the glazes and the clays, first seeing like what pigments were used for coloring, and what else we can look at the clays. So, one thing we have here is these two different clays that we looked at, and they're slightly different in color, but they're pretty similar overall hues. Even without a science background, we're able to look at the chart and see the red line and the blue line are not the same. And that's already telling us that the clay is not the same. So they're not likely made in the same location. And it's a good thing you can visualize the data even if you don't fully understand the chemistry. The other thing we looked at in the glazes is, surprise, they're toxic. So many of the glazes contain high levels of lead and even small amounts of arsenic, which helps better understand like, the dangers of infections can possess. So having the equipment in the museum allowed for like, rapid visualization of what was on the surface of the object. It was also better understanding of the dangers that ceramics infections can possess and why you really do need to be wearing gloves, even with just broken pieces of glaze pottery. It's also a better understanding of the material and better understanding of the analytical methods used. So XRF was able to say the clays were not the same, but they were sending things off to ICP in hopes to figure out where those clays are coming from. And then the other unexpected, so Emma has just talked about this one, but we'll go over it in a bit more detail. So when Emma came in and looked at it, there were some irregularities in the shape of the patina noticed, and I was asked to do the PXRF analysis. So earlier I said you can't always get things from the photograph. And this is what the actual collection photograph looked like. It doesn't, just looking at it, dispersion-wise, it doesn't actually look that strange. There's not nothing that really stands out as odd, other than maybe this weird construction there. You have a actual rectangle there, which looks like it's connecting to a handle, but it's not. It looks like a hat was what looks like a bow in an ivory handle. And otherwise it doesn't look that strange. But if you saw an Emma's photo in person, it's a completely different story. So in order to do the XLF analysis, we first looked at the actual patina, and as well as the breeding part of the egg, grading the patina when some suction, just to see what the clean metal underneath looked like. And when we did that, we found some unexpected results. Again, the patina is false. That was not ivory, despite it having straighter lines on it, which is what you get from that actual ivory growth. So somebody knew what they were doing to try to mimic ivory. And once we realize that the patina is fake and it's not ivory, we can start questioning its actual construction. So again, titanium dioxide was found in the patina and in the plaster. And this is a modern pigment dating to 1916 onwards. So when we just look at the patina alone, the patina alone contains about 65% titanium dioxide, and then about 5% iron and 5% copper. So there would have been like a binding material, possibly a wax was used to kind of put patina onto the object. But Emma, again, earlier mentioned, if we know the patina is fake, what about the actual object itself? Could it have been an older object that was poorly conserved or poorly restored in the past, and we were trying to make it look old again? Well, we looked at the actual composition of the blade itself, and no. It's a really high thin bronze with some weird trace elements that don't really show up in Egypt, so it's not a really feasible Egyptian alloy. So again, Emma asked the same questions of, if one dagger is fake, are there others? And please trace the sellers. This also leads to possible future work on this collection, because there is about 7,000 objects here. Yeah. And Gail showed me a few other ones in the collection, and there's some very strange patinas going on there, and it makes this a really interesting kind of case study for future work, for someone to bring another PXRF in and start seeing what's going on in this collection, and do the others have patinas and that match this one? Is the composition the same? So those are the things that I recently found at Bristol, but I'm not the only one who finds unusual things. So some of you might recognize Liz Thomas here. She's looking at Egyptian mirrors for her PhD. I think she has a few, is used some mirrors from a few museums here. I think you know she's used from Bristol. And I think one other museum here. So, oh, the mirrors. And me, so there's three of you. So one of the museums was recently finished. She ended up actually finding conservation work that had been carried out, but never recorded. And part of this was she found evidence in one mirror of acid stripping, where they basically stripped the entire surface to make it shiny. And another mirror she ended up finding that it had been radiated to kind of stop the corrosion, but that changes the actual metal microstructure. So that was a bit unexpected, given that the museum had said that no, these had never been to conservation work, but also said that it had been in the collection for over 100 years. And that kind of work was only done in the last 60. So it clearly had to have been done during this time in the museum collection, despite never being recorded as being conserved. And another more interesting one, I think, would be Jordan Poole, who is another PhD student at Liverpool. So Jordan was looking at Roman amulet gems. He was originally just looking at the engraving and seeing how they were made. But when he looked at one of them under a microscope, he saw there was evidence of what looked like gold. So he put it under SEM, and he found gold and traces of mercury, which gives evidence for fire gilding. And this is a bit exciting, because the museum had no idea there was gold on these. And this is actually, from Jordan, the first evidence of Roman amulet gems being gilded. So there's no published data that says that they were. So he's now writing a paper to try to publish this in hopes that other museums start looking at their own collections and seeing if they know if any of theirs had any trace of gold. So I also asked a few other museums for some opinions. So similar to the fossil dagger, Derby Museum had a student from Leeds come in, and she identified a late 19th, early 20th century Cypriot pot that had been previously labeled as an ancient one, so labeled as ancient, not ancient. And another really odd sighting kind of find came from a conservation student from Lincoln, who was able to identify a tiny bird feather from a southern African foraging basket, and that actually helped narrow down the area of where the object was found. So I think the object's initial tag just went southern Africa as the entire information and nothing else. And I'm not going to read the whole quote, but I will just summarize what I got a quote from Bev Baker from the National Justice Museum. And she was basically saying that letting people into their collections gives some new knowledge and they're able to enrich others. They enrich their collections with new information. So this case, again, the other unexpected. This is more, having students come in is more than just getting free work. They offer students a chance to gain new skills and new abilities and often offer new things both to you and museum. So one of the things I've recently done for a museum in exchange for access would be I've repackaged the coin hoard as well as reaccession and recatalogued it for them. And that's something that I can now put in my own skill set saying I have experience doing this. So students are able to add this kind of stuff to their CV and museums get free work. It leads to better understandings of the objects and renewed collection visibility, greater respect for museum collections, and letting people into your collections is a game changer for students. So you never really know where the museum, you never really know where this information will go. The museum's using new information for exhibits, for teaching, from students posting things on Twitter to actual in-person conferences. Getting new information always enhances your collection. And also can lead to better employee safety, as we've seen with the ceramics, knowing that your collection might be toxic, lead to how you can better handle things in the future, and make sure you're actually protecting yourself. So that also could lead to how you preserve objects and also keep them in the future. And it can also lead to like collaboration for future work and new discoveries and new connections. Mm-hmm. Any questions or comments? Thank you.